Grey Dale, deep in the heart of the Yorkshire Dales, is certainly one of the best venues for a World Trials Championship round. And on Sunday, March the 7th, 1982, the world's best trials riders gathered in the car park, which was situated just below Semmerwater, for round three of the World Trials Championship, which was being held for the second time at this venue and organised by the Wetherby and District Motor Club.
Wolf Carlson, you were world champion in 1980 and you've always ridden Bontessa in the World Championship Series and the European Series before that. Why have you stayed loyal to this Spanish machine?
I don't know, but I think it's just been like this, you know. For me, I've always been happy with the bike and this and everything around the team, and so I think it's that.
Yeah. You, in 1978, when Malcolm Rathbull left Montesa to go to Suzuki, you became the leader of the factory team. Has this been a great advantage to you? Have the factory helped you particularly for this?
Yeah, I think so. Because then I maybe had more work for to get better results.
Yeah. You were winner of this trial here at Bainbridge last year with a score that was nearly 70, or just about 70, beating Martin Lankin and Malcolm Rathbull. How do you fancy your chances today?
I think I have a good chance today also, because this trial fit me very well, and I like the sections and the country here, so I'm looking forward to start today.
Good, good. You prefer the straightforward type of sections rather than the tight turns that you have in the continent?
Yeah.
Good, thank you very much indeed.
Having spoken with former world champion Ulf Carlsen, I then was able to have a chat with Charlie DeMatteo, a Belgian enthusiast who travels with Eddie Lejeune.
Charlie DeMatteo from Belgium, you've been going to the World Championship Trials for quite some while, and you've become very well known because you have a metal sheet with all the riders' names and the number of marks they've lost, and everybody knows before you they've handed their punch cards in how many marks they've lost and who's winning the trial. How did your interest in World Championship Trials start?
Oh, through 69.
Yes.
I begin in 69. With Jean-Marie Lejeune.
Yeah, and you followed with Eddie Lejeune now?
Yeah, now with Eddie Lejeune. I drive for Eddie.
You drive his vehicle?
Yeah,
around.
And all the world.
Yeah, and do you go for all the trials?
Yeah.
And you've become very well known, and everybody is happy to give you their card first and get the result verified by you, and everybody knows the result before.
Yeah, I try to have all the results.
Good, good. Thank you very much.
Charlie is keeping a record of all point scorers in World Championship Trials to provide a record for Eddie Lejeune, who looks very likely to be one of the future winners of this championship.
Eddie Lejeune, you have won the first two rounds of this year's World Championship. How do you think the Honda will go today in the British trial?
I think Honda is very good. It's me. I'm not every day in very good form. I hope today is good day. My bike is okay. It's for me. Very
okay.
Good.
You don't think you are riding very well, but you have still won two trials.
Yes, perhaps. I don't like very good river. I don't like today is many river.
Yes, I think you are right. You have always ridden the Honda four-stroke. Why do you want to stay to the four-stroke rather than two-stroke machines?
I like four-stroke. I think for me it's too easy. No problem with engine. I think it's very good.
Do you find the Honda very easy to keep going?
Yes, I think Honda is very good.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The week before in Belgium, Jaime Subira, the Fantic Works rider from Spain, crashed and badly hurt his back, and it was a surprise just to see him at the trial in danger.
Jaime Subira, at the beginning of last year you began the development of the 240 Fantic and you didn't score in the early world rounds, but then later on in the series you scored in the final eight. How do you think you will ride this year?
Well, I get many illusions with this year because I get much better preparation, physical condition, and the bike is ready and it's a hot one to do it before. Now all these things are ready, but the only problem is in Belgium I get a small accident, and I don't know how I do today because my back is not in perfect condition. But anyway, I think much better than last year.
Ah, good. Last week in Belgium, you fell over walking a section,
yeah,
and then crashed off a rock step. What actually happened?
Well, my feet just slip,
yes,
and I get a big crash in the back, the end of the column.
Yes, the vertebra.
And I get a very big crash there, and I lost the what's the name?
The balance.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
And I go to the hospital. Impossible to continue.
Yeah.
The trial. And the first moment they say that it's broken, but after I go to the special doctor,
yeah,
and he's watching very well and says it's not broken, and make special injections, and I try today, I don't know.
Oh, good.
Wow.
Well, I wish you the very best and hope that you can ride better than fourth place that you had at home in Spain.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
With the first riders leaving the start area, the first section was only just out of the car park. Every rider leaves at a minute intervals, flagged off by Jack Hardy, the club's starter. In the background is David Weatherall, who did most of the work for the very good programme that Weatherby produced. And riding to the first section is Italian Lino Della Rodolfo. Now at the first section, world champion Gilles Berger watches John Hemingway tackle the first hazard. Now John wasn't actually riding in the trial, for the club sent a few first class riders around the course to ride some of the sections and do their best to scrub the slime off. It was a ploy that only worked reasonably well, for some of the early riders had quite a few problems with slime on the sections and they acted as scrubbers when many of them would have wished to have been later on in the entry. This is a Swedish rider on a SWM, Lars Karlsson, who's riding the 125 version, one of the few people to ride one of the smaller bikes. Again, Lino Della Rodolfo takes his 240 Fantic through. Steve Monk, riding the Yamaha Majesty, built by John Sheriff at Buxton. Nigel Crowther on the 250 Ossa was watched by a very good crowd in a nice bit of sunshine. Certainly welcome in March after a very bad winter with a lot of snow in the area. And Nigel's score is recorded as a zero, one of the first cleans in this section, which did turn out to be quite easily. Canadian champion Stanley Backyard came to England to ride a few World Championship rounds and tackle the Scottish, but unfortunately he didn't get into the Scottish, as his name was not drawn out of the hat for the infamous ballot, and he returned to Canada very shortly after this trial. However, while he was here, he did make a very good impression with the Northern Centre riders with whom he stayed. Derek Edmondson is one of Britain's top enduro men, doesn't ride trials so much these days, but has still lost none of his touch. A couple of dabs there, but he soon gets back onto form later in the trial. Not a top 10 contender by any means, but a very keen and enthusiastic rider whose father is the man behind Rock Shots. Steve Monk is a rider who deserves more results than he seems to get. He has a very careful and calculating style, always on the clutch. He tends to stop and balance and go and stop and balance and go. And he's very impressive to watch, but unfortunately his results don't quite match up his performance, which is a shame. However, he has received some backing from Subaki Race Chain in 1982, and this is a boost to a very nice young lad from the London area. Spaniard Xavier Miguel scored his first ever World Championship point last year and is doing all of the 1982 events. Speaks no English at all, so he could have a quiet day unless he manages to team up with a fellow Spaniard. As Brett Bailey walks out of the way, Tony Calvert, who lives just minutes from the start, tackles the section on his dory, takes a dab. Tony's been around for quite a long time, former Northern Centre Trials champion, is now sponsored by Gori, having ridden Bultaco and Ossa. He should be well familiar with this terrain. The second section of the trial was a muddy, rocky gully, and when the first riders went up, that's the pace setters rather than the actual entrant, Rob Shepherd, who used to ride the Works Honda, was one of these, and it was so difficult that Rob couldn't do anything better than a three. Yet here, after perhaps just 20 or 30 attempts, the riders are managing to get up without too many problems. Just exiting there is Fred Michaud from Spain, the elder brother of Terry Michaud. John Reynolds, in his controversial helmet, which is fitted with a chin cup, has been asked by the ACU to get another helmet, but as yet hasn't done so. John's watching Gilles Berger, the defending world champion, who gets in quite a bit of trouble there, but gets out of it with a dab, recovers well, and completes the section just for that single mark, with a nice little turn at the end. Cliff Carlson, world champion in 1981, riding number two as runner-up last year. A very good team. The man many riders favour for the championship this year, Bernie Schreiber. Now on SWM after an unhappy season on Idlejet. Tackled the corner in very convincing style and makes the section look very easy indeed. An excellent ride there from Eddie Lejeune on the Honda, a favourite with the crowds, the only competitive four-stroke in the trial as Reynolds comes up. Wears blue gloves, woolen gloves. One of the few riders to insist on wearing gloves all the time. And he's followed by Spaniard Tony Gorga. Yeah. Summer water in the background makes a fine setting for this World Championship trial. And we've moved on to sections 8 and 9, at the furthest part of the course, and these are the first really difficult sections of the trial. The gentleman on the left there with the flat hat is Barry Robinson, a Yorkshireman who writes for all the magazines and local newspapers, providing reports of Yorkshire trials, and he's a keen and enthusiastic spectator. Alan Stay from the Isle of Wight unfortunately had to retire from today's trial with a very bad migraine, but before he retired he was going very well indeed. Very impressive for a lad from an island that just doesn't have any rocks at all. He stopped there, but prior to that he was having some very good rides. Another Yorkshireman, last year's centre champion, Brett Haley. Brett's on the CCM built at Bolton using the Italian motor. All these first riders through this section are having a hard time with it at the moment, simply because the rocks are so slippery and greasy, and they're acting as pathfinders for the championship contenders who will be coming along shortly. Barry there, just in the corner, disappearing out of the picture, showing a lot of interest in Brett's performances. Hero Vestreeman, 3 times World Trials champion, and the most successful man in the history of the World Trials Championship. At the time of this trial, he had won more world rounds than any other man. This is Jean-Marie Lejeune, the elder brother of the factory Honda rider Eddie. Now, can't quite be seen on his bike just then, but it was fitted with Honda hubs rather than Montesa hubs. And that's in case Eddie has wheel trouble. Presumably he can borrow the wheel out of brother Jean-Marie's Mont. Steve Robson in a bit of trouble. Finding what it is to have short legs. Going back to the Lejeunes, that's quite a good idea of the Lejeune family to protect Eddie's interests wherever it's possible. For while Jean-Marie's a good rider, to have a spare set of pubs going around is certainly no bad thing. Hopefully we should be able to see the wheels a bit more clearly in a later picture. Dave Tinkard from the Southern Centre. He's having a bit of trouble on this section with his SWM. There's Barry Robinson again. Oh, he's still keeping an eye on Prince Performances. Looks very interested. I've seen it all before. Alberto Juventano, a nice little hop round that corner there, gets him right into trouble. He's from Spain, rides the Ossa, 350 model. Chris Sutton doing an Alberto Juventano impression with the very similar helmet and the very similar beard, and riding a very similar machine when he comes up. Fred Michoud again, we saw him on the second section. He's a Bultaco rider from France, sponsored by the French importers. Not quite in the class of his younger brother Thierry, but still very good. All the top men have now arrived in the section. Berg at number one there, watching his countryman tackle the hazard. Pushrod Palmer in the foreground watches Scott Head ride. He comes to an immediate halt on this first difficult bit. And now Chris Sutton. Sooty, as he's affectionately known, is the son of Rag Sutton, who follows Chris all around the countryside. Rag, a butcher from the Guildford area. Sooty is really going well on the Ossa this year, having spent the last season with Montesa. He was left in the cold at the end of season musical bikes and had moved to Ossa, and a successful move that's been too. Mark Buron, his reputation was rather an unfortunate one, for in the Scottish a few years ago, his Montesa caught fire on the first day and he had to retire with the bike almost completely burnt out. On a Fantic now, this very likeable Dutchman who speaks perfect English found a bit of trouble in today. Moving to the top of the section, Martin Lampkin comes to a crashing five there. It really was unfortunate. He had been clean to that point and he just stopped just before the end. A real unfortunate five for Mark. Bushrod Palmer on a Gory, which is rather a strange combination when he's nicknamed Pushrod, but Roy used to ride a Honda a lot in trials and very successfully too. He rode the 250 TL when it was a production machine available in this country, but has now moved on to two-stroke power. Harold Crawford was over in Yorkshire from Ireland and he made a very good impression on the British fans who were seeing him for the first time. A five there, but not to be disgraced in such distinguished company. Howard is the current Ulster champion and he's sponsored by the Montesa Importer in Ireland. We notice all these riders are wearing bibs supplied by the Wetherby Club. This is a requirement of the FIM, that's the organising body of World Motorcycle Sport, that all riders must wear bibs rather than have numbers, paper numbers on their machines. The top 10 in the world last year are numbered 1 to 10 in their finishing positions, and they hold that number throughout the year. At each trial, the top 10 are balloted so that they get a fair starting order in the middle of the remainder of the entry. Now, Manuel Soler must have seen our cameraman here, because he goes behind this tree and flatly refuses to come into sight. Now, we have a lovely view of a tree here. The bark is really attractive, but Manuel insists on staying there. We think he's lining himself up for the section, but I really think he's just going for it. You see, he really doesn't want to come out and see it, but he's decided to. Oh, that's good. Manuel scored in the first round of the World Trials Championship in Spain, having won it the previous year, but failed to score here today, and in fact after this trial went into hospital for an operation to his knee. Reputation as a bit of a playboy, nevertheless a very, very good rider who has won several world rounds. Now the man they all want to see ride the section, Eddy Lejeune. Sticking to the Honda 4-stroke, having tried Montessori in the flow season, he picks his path very nicely, using the clutch all the time. Very controlled, a single dab, but ease it out and it's there. Just that one pull. Timo Risi from Finland makes the long journey across the North Sea to Britain and to all the European trials. Has remained faithful to Vultaco for quite some while. Always wears that particular distinctive helmet. Ulf Carlsen. Now there you can see just how slimy these rocks are. Even the dry one there doesn't really show much signs of having any grip on it. And this is, quite simply, Britain's problem. You cannot produce world champions from such conditions. Although we're hoping that John Lampkin proves us wrong. Pirjo Vesterinen, now based in England and riding the Comerford Vultaco. Nice little bunny hop for the end for a good turn.
Hey, he's filming me. Yes, he is.
Eddy Lejeune, the section after the one we've just watched. Now just watch how everybody follows Eddie's tyre tracks. The moment he gets into the section, everybody follows him. Must be something about Castrolar, they're all drugged on it. Fair enough. Right, all behind him, boys. Now off we go. Follow him up the section. That's it. Come on, John. Go on, you lead. That's it, John. And a round of applause for a very good clean. Now there must be something wrong with Bernie, because they don't follow him up here. Bernie will take a dab at the top, but he just doesn't have the same... Must be the same smell, I suppose. Look, nobody wants to follow him. Perhaps he's not quite good enough. Tony Gorga. Over the rocks, quick dab where a lot of riders were having their mark. Dustin. He's had a prop, but he's had it on the other side. Eddie Lejeune again. Second, third. Third gear he's gone into for this section. Now you look at it when he gets there. That takes some courage to ride a bike up a section in third gear as short and as steep as this. But such is the gripping power of the Honda over the step and very slowly out in third gear. There isn't so many two-strokes that could do that. American Scott Head scored 2 points in the opening round in Spain, hasn't scored since. But a very likeable young man and a good, attractive proposition for Eiffel Jet. Not a particularly difficult section, but it takes... Does it? No. Yes. Just a mark off Scott there. Ulf Karlsson, former world champion, has been riding Montesso ever since he started. He's tackled all the world championship trials ever since they began in 1975, and prior to that, the European series. Tony Gorbach again. Last year with Ossa, a Spanish champion, won the Italian round in 1981. Moved to Montesso in the close season and has really found form. The start area, and you can see by the cars parked all in the background and the colourful transporters and caravans just what a bright and colourful scene it is. That's the club chairman, Pete Fletcher, taking off in his helicopter. You might as well do it in style if you're the boss. Chris Sutton on his second lap towards the end of the circuit. This section had been changed from the first lap when it was particularly easy. In fact, there was hardly any marks lost on it at all. And even now, it didn't really prove tricky, didn't really prove difficult, but nevertheless still took the odd mark. Tony Calvert. Over the little step and up the bank to the end. With his car punched. All the riders have punch cards around the neck. These are plastic sheets which have got 0, 1, 2, 3, 5 against each section number, and the observer simply punches a hole in the score that he loses, and at the end of the trial the officials just add up the marks down. bloody hell, one of the most difficult sections in the trial. Over in the farthermost corner from the start, it was a long trek for the spectators, least of all our cameraman who had to lug all his gear there. But what a section, well worth it. Jamie Subira, number 9. That means he was 9th in last year's World Trials champion, and he's in problems. Front wheel of his Fantic against that step, and fellow countryman Pedro Oli pulling him out. A lot of spectators there for being so far away from the start. An American Bernie Shriver, number 6, walked up with Vesti, number 3, and Eddie Levine, number 4. Wondering just how on earth they're going to manage to clean it. Brett Haley, he starts a dab, so he's not going to tell them how it's done. It's very difficult for any camera to convey just how difficult and how steep this section was. But mark my words, it's one of the most tremendous and ferociously difficult sections ever seen. No wonder it's called Bloody Hell. Keith Wilson, your producer here today, looked at this section several weeks before the trial as he walked the course with Clark, of course, Ken Smith, and just couldn't believe that a motorbike would go up there. Even when he left, he wasn't convinced that it would. However, as you can see, they're managing it. But as yet, there's still no clings. Eddie Lejeune begins his ride up this hazard. And he's going well. Makes the turn. And it's over the rocks. And a dab to get the Honda gripping, but both feet down. And wiggle your way to the top. With Dusty watching from halfway up. Jean-Marie Lejeune, you remember me saying earlier about having Honda hubs in his Montesa? Not possible to see from this angle, but if you look carefully, you might just be able to catch a glimpse as he travels up the section. Now you can see that they're not Montesa hubs. They are Honda. Good ride from Jean-Marie. Oh, I spoke too soon. Oh, what a crash. And Galeazzi reckons it's funny. Galeazzi, the Italian champion, number 51 there. Hey, Jean-Marie. Big fiasco, eh? Hey, what do you reckon about that, Gilles? You gonna do it? Still talking about it. Britain Steve Moore travels with Dave Clinkard around the countryside. Makes a very good attempt. A very nice lad who's never really gets top quality results, but he's always there all the time. Reduced to a bout of legging, which eventually becomes a 5. But nevertheless, a very good attempt for a long way up this extremely difficult section. This is Nicolas Denoyer, a Frenchman who travels with Gilles Bergat. At home in France, Nicolas acts as Bergat's mechanic and is no mean rider in his own right. Very good friend with Gilles. Deserves that round of applause he gets as John Reynolds walks the section to plan his path. The old Galeazzi, sleazy Galeazzi, he's still looking. American Scott Head. One finger on the clutch and going well. This is the difficult, that's where the problem is. Getting over that step after the turn. And that big rock. What a vicious little so-and-so it is. completely a wet bum. All trials riders know about wet bums. Now then, this is the ride to watch. Bernie Schreiber gets into difficulty right at the very beginning, but he recovers so well. Well worth watching. Oh, he's in trouble. And he's away from it. Back into control. Around the corner. The right-hander. And the left-hander. And over the step. He'll slide off over that rock and up. And in terrible difficulties, but with a little wiggle there, he's out through the wall at the top. And a well-deserved round of applause. That ride takes some beating. And unfortunately, Renato Chiaberto is not going to be, I beg your pardon, Pedro Oli on the beater. He's not going to be the one to do it. Pedro Oli on this beater is developing it for a major onslaught on the market in late 1982 and early 1983. Fast as a 240, in fact the machine is a 196cc. Frenchman Charles Coutard, many times French champion, now sporting a beard, obviously to keep the winter chill off. Signed for Bultaco this year, having been with Montesa and SWM in the past few seasons. To return to his old love, the Spanish Bulto. Obviously well at home with the bike. Another well deserved round of applause from the appreciable crowd. I see Reynolds is still there, not one to hurry himself, is he? Surprise world champion last year, 11th in 1980 in the series, first in 1981. What an incredible ride. Did it on the Italian SWM, and rather surprisingly moved to Fantic for this year. Rumoured problems, but obviously quite happy with his performance there. Last section of the trial. And we're very lucky to catch John Lampkin achieve a brilliant clean. And John went on to score 10th place and take a single World Championship point. Norman Shepherd. Oh, what a gaunting five. Norman, the younger brother of former Honda Works rider Rob, is now on SWM, having been on Yamaha in 1981. One of the nicest of the many Yorkshire riders, and a great guy. Makes another attempt at the final couple of steps. Marshall George Webb there, who has a motorcycle and sportswear clothing business. Terry Michaud, the younger brother of Fred, who was seen on the ball carpet earlier in this first class video, makes a very good attempt on this 30th hazard in the trial. As you can see at this time of the day, dusk is drawing in, and it's been a long, hard and very tiring day for these riders. Hungary's Chris Myers makes a second attempt at the very slippery still drop step. Nick Jeffries, son of the famous Alan Jeffries, manages the family motorcycle business at Shipley and riding the Hero engine Armstrong CCM. Another one who finds these steps very tricky. However, John Lampkin on that first bit of the film we saw here proved that it can be cleaned. And on that quick thing. Well, not that much thing. Mark Jackson is the rider, and he is sponsored by Nick Jeffries, who we saw go up just before. I said, Mark, I should make it head for home. Notice the more pressure starts on the air there, something that all drivers' bikes should do. Martin Carlson, another of the Swedes, he makes a good attempt to get up there. At this time of the trial, no doubt he's just glad to be up. Crowd is noticeably thinned. Many of the spectators will have started to make their way home before they've travelled many, many miles to get here. Crowd rumoured to be at around 3,000. It's very good for a World Championship trial. As Renato Chiaberto, who I mistakenly confused with Pedro Oli from the section called Bloody Hell. Don't quite know how I made that mistake, but Renato rides the Otter and Oli rides the Beta. Now this is how we do it, Burks. Peter Cartwright is the teacher, and he's obviously got it all weighed up. I don't know what he's putting all the turns in for, because it looks a pretty straight section to me. And Burke's saying, look, I think we'd better worry about that bit down the bottom. Do you reckon we'll Burke? Burke was obviously right, because that's where he got into trouble. Those long legs doing well to do him up there. Now he hasn't fired because the section ended there. He didn't have to turn to get out. That water's still going to come down for a long while yet. And an awful lot will have to come down before those rocks disappear. And that's where we must disappear to the final interviews. But before those final interviews, the riders will have been handing in their punch cards. And Jeff Scully, the father of rider Glenn Scully, is putting the results up on the board. And by now, it will be clear that Bernie Shriver won the trial by 4 marks from Eddie Lejeune. Spaniard Tony Gorgop had his best ride to date in the series, with 3rd place on 52, while Jules Berger came in 4th in 56. Charles Coulthard was next, and he just picked his fellow Bultrafa teammate Ilio Vestrina. With Galeazzi from Italy filling 7th, Martin Lampkin was the best British rider on 8th, Malcolm Rathnall came home 9th, and John Lampkin, Martin's young nephew, grabbed the final championship point. Now Peter Cartwright here is obviously in some doubt as to whether his punch card is right, and he's just checking the score with going with 2 trial secretaries, Moira Morton. If Peter thinks he's going to get away with anything, I'm afraid he's mistaken, for Moira will make sure that his score is correct. And of course, the inevitable job of having to clear up. And of course, the autograph hunting.
By your own standards, Mark.